Good evening. One announcement before we start. Next Tuesday and the one after, I will be in Israel. So we'll be back in 3 weeks from now. It will be February 5th. The next lecture, 5th of February. Please remember that. In general, always check online on my website the day of the lecture on events. If something went wrong, weather, snowstorm, you never know. So I usually never cancel a lecture. Tonight I had a very big yetzer hara to cancel the lecture, but it's not an option because I have a flight in the morning to Israel. And I heard that they're having strike there, the TSA, what do you call it? Because of the government strike. I really hope it's just a rumor. It's very bad. Imagine this, they can start canceling flights all over America, and the country would lose billions of dollars every week just from canceling flights. So we don't really know what's going to be. This government shutdown, it's a very big problem because a few million people in this country don't get paid. They don't get paid. I don't have to tell you when people don't get paid what happened. They begin to do all kinds of demonstrations, and it can go out of control. And all of that has only one purpose. What is the purpose? The traders, the Democrats, they will do everything they can that more immigrants and more cartel and more drug dealers and more murderers and more terrorists and more rapists will come into this country, that we should sponsor them, and they'll torture us. That's what they care about. That's what they want. Every normal human being, if you are a politician, you got elected by the people, you have to protect the people. You have to protect the country. Why in the world a person will have mercy on strangers that are not his nation and are not his family and are not in his city? He will have mercy on strangers that he have nothing to do with, even if they're good people. Forget about all cartel and crime. Forget it. Let's say everyone is decent. Fine. Why in the world you will go out of your way to protect strangers by hurting your own people? Do you see what happens when you don't have Torah? All your priorities in life are mixed. I see it every second. Not only in immigration, not only in government, in life. I give you an example. You have a couple, they get married. They're not rich families. The parents forcing a fancy event. Forcing. They have spent over $100,000 on a stupid wedding. 2 hours, flowers and sushi and steaks and extra band and who knows what else. For the 2 hour show off. And then you live with that 5 years to pay it back. With the divorce rate today, most people even won't make it to the first payment. I told you that I have a friend. He had an order to do Sheva Brachot 2 days after the wedding. The next morning, the woman called and said, don't deliver the food. It was a Thursday night. Don't deliver the food. Why? It won't happen. They're already getting a get. 2 days after the wedding. The divorce rate is keep going up. What is the max that it's going to get to? Well, it's going to become 100% in the end? In some places in the world today, there's more than 100% divorce rate. How can it be? How can it be more than 100% divorce rate? Who knows? Some of them get divorced 5-6 times. It brings the statistic higher from 100%. If you have in that city 100,000 people, that should be 50,000 couples, more or less. You know, if you eliminate the children for a minute. So if 50,000 couples, each one of them get divorced 3-4 times, It brings us that there are some who do not get divorced, but there's people that would get divorced so many times, each one, it brings the statistic to more than 100%. It's crazy. Many secular people beginning to understand that they should not get married. They just live together without commitments, without anything. They have children. Nobody is ashamed anymore today. No one is ashamed. Rav Moshe Feinstein's grandson told me that when Rav Moshe Feinstein was in a hospital, that was 30 years ago, one black nurse came, Goya, not Jewish. She came and she was talking about her 14 years old girl that has a baby. Oh, my daughter had a baby. Out of the marriage, from somebody in a school, elementary school, high school. So Moshe Feinstein told him, and you know, he was so humble and so righteous. He told him, you see in front of your eyes an example what Sodom and Gomorrah means. That people live and act and behave like animals, and there's no more shame about it. People used to do animal acts always in history. Because the Torah say, "Kema'aseh eretz Mitzrayim lo ta'asu." Do not behave like these Egyptians. And the Gemara brings an example of what they used to do. Homosexuality, relationship with animals, one woman with two men, a man with few women. It was a whole zoo. But he said, Moshe Feinstein, this is what the Torah talks about. He says, so back in time, when people wanted to make all these sins, they used to be very, very strict about it. That God forbid no one would know about it, because the shame was huge. What? You have a daughter 14 years old and she already have a baby and you smile? My daughter had a baby. No more shame. Just like animals. Just like a monkey became pregnant by someone who passed by. And they're all happy with their new baby. The monkeys. What do they understand? This is it. We became worse than animals. The Gemara in Masechet Eruvin say, "Ilmale nitna Torah." If we would not get the Torah, we would be worse than the animals, clearly. Worse than the animals. The animals have more manners than us. I give you an example. The ant, they live 6 months. They collect wheat and rice that they drag into the place where they store their food to dozens of decades. They only live 6 months. The amount of food, 1.5 piece of wheat or barley, 1.5. It's enough for an ant for their entire life. You drag one rice and another half. That's enough for the ant for their entire life to live. How long does it take? 2 hours, 3 hours, that's it. Not like us. We have to work every day, otherwise next week he won't have money. He constantly have to work. The ant, in one day of work, it's enough for the rest of their life, but it keeps working. That's why King Solomon say, "Lazy, get up and go and learn from the ant. Look how hard they work from sunrise to sunset. Non-stop." So that's one thing to teach the lazy people, work ethics. And dogs and cats. When they go to the bathroom, they cover it. How many people go in the airport in the bathroom and don't flush? How many? Half of the people. That's why I hate the airport so much. I feel like I'm in a zoo. Not only how the people dress, not only how they look, not the haircuts, the way, the clothes that they wear. The atmosphere over there is horrible. Mamash, you feel like you come to the heart of Sodom. It's you know what it is? Religious people used to have a shelter that they can hide themselves somewhere without seeing the zoo of the world and all the disaster around us. But today, there's no way to run. Because if you want to run, you cannot fly one time in your life. It's enough. You have to go to an airport. Here you go. You cannot avoid it. Some rabbis you hear, they don't walk here. They don't enter Manhattan. They will never walk on King's Highway, especially summertime. They hide in the house. They don't come out to the street. They want to watch their eyes. Beautiful. But what happened? They have to fly every 2-3 weeks. comes the airport and mess up everything. You can't be holy anymore. This is it. Unless you're a very poor person living in a cave in the middle of nowhere and cutting plants in the desert and eat. That's really the only option. Disconnected from the world, no electric, no electronic. How many people like this you know? Crazy. So Moshe Feinstein said to his grandson, this was 30-something years ago. Today it's 1,000 times worse. He said to him, this is what the Torah meant, Kema'ase Eretz Mitzrayim lo ta'asu. On the open, with no shame. No shame. Sodom and Gomorrah, Egypt, these places. No shame. No shame. Life without the shame is very dangerous. Shame is a very good police. Shame is better than the police, you know that? Because even if you know the police is not around, you're still embarrassed from people. Who is more productive preventing burglary? Police or shame? Which one of them prevented more robberies? Police or shame? Shame. You want to come break a glass on the street. You keep looking. Who's here? Someone is walking. You're waiting. Another person is walking. You're waiting. You're waiting. You're waiting. Then you give up. You leave. The shame just saved you from committing a sin from the Torah. So, it's really very concerning because the many secular people already came to the conclusion that there's no point of getting married. You want to ask my opinion? They're definitely right. What's the point of getting married? They cheat. They disrespect each other. They do horrible things. There's no more modesty. No more modesty. Someone told me that there are a lot of married people in the show business that they talk to men in front of the whole world, in live television. Like, I love you, I'm in love with you, you're so handsome. She has a husband and kids in the house, and her husband has to sit and watch this. What do you think it does? It brainwashed the mind of the kids. All the kids who go now and get married, what do they have in mind? That it's perfectly fine. They corrupt the mind of the children. I don't think there's anything more dangerous than to let children have access to the television and to the internet. I just met someone and he told me, we spoke about what the world has become. An older person, getting close to 70. He told me, and he's not so religious. Shomer Shabbat, he's not a frum person. You cannot call him very religious. But Shomer Shabbat. Traditional, like they say. He told me, I'm very concerned from what the world has become. He told me, I think if Mashiach won't come, this world is going to become totally, totally a mess. I say it already became a mess. Then he says to me, you know, I have television at home. He told me, you know, the other day I was flipping channel in my television. It's 500 channels. 500 channels. When I was a kid, there were two channels. Two channels, and most people didn't have television. Family had to gather once a week to watch a show by one family member in black and white. That's what people didn't look as bad as today. But that was the beginning of the downfall. He told me, I go to channel 500 and something. This is his words an hour ago. What do I see, he tells me. The worst dirty movie you can imagine. I asked him, what time was it? He said, between 9 and 10. That means children sitting in a bedroom and have access to these things. Who would believe such thing? The parents. How can they live? How can you live a day knowing that your children have access to these things? How can you live? Definitely better to be dead than to watch these things, that your children doing things like this. Then you wonder why she's 14 years old and she's pregnant, sending them to public school, and this is what the kids over there watch every day. Every time I have guests in my house, now we had a lot of guests from Atlanta, lots of guys. they get the shock of their life when they see the kids in our neighborhood compared to the kids where they come from. They just cannot believe it. You know, their family, sister, brother, they go to the house and see how the kids talk. Then they come, they see religious kids, manners, the way they dress, suits, jackets, hats, getting up in the morning, coming to shul. You see right away, clean kids and dirty kids. You see right away, spiritually I'm talking. Mamash like this. For them, it's a shock. I don't know what makes them more religious. The talk and the conversations and the convincing, or actually coming to a religious environment and see how people look totally different than the world they live in. This guy is a locksmith. This guy installed garage door. This guy is a real estate agent. They deal with the goyim on a daily basis. They go to places. They go into their houses. They absorb the dirt of the world nonstop on a daily basis. Then you take them away for 4 or 5 days from their environment. You put them in Monsi. They go all day to the yeshiva. They see Gemara. They come to our house. They eat Shabbat, shul. One of them decided to stay, not to go back to Atlanta. I already said that's it. I'm surprised only one. The other ones, it's just a matter of time. People are too much into the money. The hunger for money is more than it's ever been. It's all about money, money, money. They're pumping into your head all the time. Successful, rich, cars, this. Brainwash the kids. Every kid that doesn't have a way to become a billionaire like his father or his grandfather almost always will push himself into drug dealing and crime and stealing identity and credit card frauds. They don't want to work. Why are they going to work? Like a slave and make $40,000 a year? This is very dangerous. Rich parents, the biggest crimes they do to their children is raising them like princes. Because they decreed on them a death penalty from a very young age. You should know what I'm saying now. I hope you understand what I'm saying. Raising your daughter like a Jap, Jewish American princess, giving her everything, giving her maid, giving her a nice Mercedes when she's 17 or 16, I don't know. Giving her unlimited credit card, all day shopping, jewelry, clothing, boots, bags, this. And then one day she has to get married. If she wants to get married to a good religious boy who goes and learns Torah, he cannot give her this kind of life. How long this marriage would last? Maximum a week. After a week, and I have to start thinking, how do we get them divorced? All she cares about is the addiction to shopping. So why you marry a Jewish boy? Marry a Saudi sheikh. Convert to Islam and become Fatma. In Dubai, he'll give you everything you want. Yes, you won't even have to see him. He's just going to send you everything you want. You want to marry a Bachur Yeshiva? So what do you think happened to these boys? They give up on life. They don't want to live anymore. They're embarrassed to take money from their parents. And they have to supply more than $100,000 a year in first year just to supply their addictions. And they begin with the depression pills and these pills and drugs and who knows what else. That's what's going on right now. Now, today, I appreciate my uncle more than ever. I had an uncle. Baruch Hashem, I had the zchut to influence him the last few years of his life to make him Shomer Shabbat. At least he put tefillin, he was Shomer Shabbat, he had kosher, he was an honest person, he was a very humble person. That's going to save him in Olam Haba, at least partially. But all the years he was secular, but all these years he was such a successful businessman with such great senses. Everything he touched turned into gold. He knew to buy land in Israel when he was peanuts, and then he became private and went up thousands of percent. If he saw opportunities, he knew, he bought. He always made money, always. And I always wondered as a kid, why my cousins live like me? My father was not rich, worked very hard for a living, a worker, cutting diamonds for someone, not rich. But they were very rich, a lot of money. The father was making tons of money, but they lived more simple like us. And then I had another cousin that was also very rich, not like them, but very rich also. And his father made all the possible mistakes he can think of, giving him the car, giving him cash, stuffs of cash, every night goes out, this, that. Messed up his life. Poor guy. Today you have to see that nothing left from the wealth. He works like a slave until 9 p.m. in Israel to come home. His marriage is a disaster. Everything is a disaster in his life. It's a miracle. His marriage was already dead 10 times. 10 times. But him and his wife have nowhere to go. So they somehow keeps coming back together. They have nowhere to go. Some people have where to go. They run. Then my other cousins, with a very rich father, all of them grew up decent people. Baruch Hashem, I had the schut to make them all religious. But it wasn't difficult to make them religious because they were decent people. They always worked hard. They were always down to earth, never show off. They never wear all kinds of fancy clothes, no fancy car, no nothing. Now they build themselves nice private homes. But also, in not the best area, okay, average. He raised them in such a way that they had to work from a very young age to make the money and to appreciate the money. You think that this is love, giving your children unlimited money? You will cry for it for the rest of your life. You wait and see when they grow up. You wait and see when they come to age 20, 21, 22. They got used to living a life standard of spending hundreds of thousands of dollars a year. They live in a nice mansion, a lot of Jews are rich, their children live in nice big homes with maids, eating well. Nobody sits and counts how much we can spend and how much we cannot spend. Leasing cars, fancy cars in the driveway, whatever they want they have. Until when? Until they have to leave the house. You're not going to buy them a mansion now to every one of your kids. So now they have to go to one or two bedroom apartments. They have to do their own laundry. They have to wake up in the morning. They have to go work and bring money just to pay for their expenses, for the car lease, for the rent, for the food, which is not enough. How much a person makes in America? A college graduate, master degree, how much he makes? 70, 60, 80, 90? It's not enough. He was spending it on a credit card of his father or she, more of that every year. Now he cannot live. It's a disaster. Disaster. Then they wonder why every other kid in America is a drug addict. And the other half is all in depression. Depression. I told you once, somebody asked me in 2008, 2009, have I really stayed crushed now? I don't have what to do anymore. I can't buy and sell like I used to. What do you suggest I should invest my money in? I told him, invest in depression pills, Prozac, things like this. He thought I'm joking. Ma? Say, yeah, locate all the famous depression pills, the companies that make them, buy the stocks and sit a few years. Triple this money. What are you going to say? Oh, I'm a genius, I'm a prophet, nothing. Simple common sense. Everything in this country, it's all about material. No spirituality, no righteousness, no nothing. No connection to Hashem. Like animals. Have more, more, more. More female, more food, more jumping into the water, more jumping on the trees, meaning sport. That's the culture. So as long as you have money, you can afford. So you live in illusion that you enjoy life. What happens when the money runs out? When real estate crash, you have big debts, they raise your interest rate. We are in front of a disaster in this country, you should know that. In front of a disaster. This disaster will be worse than 2008. Wait until they raise the interest rate another once or twice, and you'll see what's going to happen here. millions of foreclosures again, unemployed people, banks will collapse. But this time it will be worse. Someone that knows economic, he told me something very scary, very scary. He told me that Russia and China holds more than $101 trillion in their reserves. And they want to sell it all and change it to a different currency. Do you know what would happen? Right now, American dollar worth 3.67 shekel today. A week ago, it was 3.78. It went down 3%, 4% in 1 week. I guess people in the market beginning to know that Putin decided to take revenge against America together with China. Because you go against Russia and against China, they are not little kids in a kindergarten that you can smack them. And they stand in a corner and cry. This is mafia people. Putin is mafia, gangster. And the Chinese, I don't have to tell you what they do to their own people when they don't behave. So what do you think is going to happen? They're going to sell all the they dump all the American dollars. The dollar will come to less than one shekel. Meaning when the people would like to leave America, they're not going to be able to buy even what they can buy here. Right now, your money worth something. You go to Israel, $1 is almost 4 shekel. If the money will go down and you're going to have half a shekel for a dollar, you know what's going to happen? You want to buy a house in Israel, you're going to pay 4 times more than a house here. That's why I told people already 2-3 weeks ago, better to take all your money out of America. Change your money to Chinese currency or to currency that will not lose their value and buy real estate in Israel. Jerusalem prices will not go down. Even the whole world is collapsing. You saw in Israel the real estate prices did not go down. So you have few apartments or few houses in Israel. Even you rented it now. You don't make so much money. You rented it. But at least you keep the value of your money. Over here, the money is going to go down. If they're really going to release $101 trillion to the market, the dollar will become toilet paper. How long it's going to take them to do it, I don't know. And probably they're selling a lot of dollars as it is. Why the dollar came down 4% in 1 week? It never happens. The movement of the dollar is very conservative. Yeah, no, it's not business classes. It's our reality. It's what's going to happen to us in the next year. This is reality, Rabotai. Torah, it's reality. The Torah is connected to our life and connected to the world. And the Gemara say, Chacham, Chacham, Enav Berosho. Chacham, that means he has eyes in his head. Meaning some people have eyes, but they don't see. The Chacham is someone that has eyes, but he uses it correctly. And the Pirkei Avot say, Ezu hachacham haroe et hanolad. Who is a wise man that predicts the future? Not because he's a prophet. He predicts the future. I'll give you an example. If you come to Monsi and you see there's no more rooms, you can rent an apartment in a religious community. Everything is taken. They build another building, right away it's all rented. Build another one, right away it's all rented. More and more people from Brooklyn and from other places move over there. Can't live over here. Can't raise children over here. Can't let your children come out of the house here in Brooklyn. So what happened? You don't have to be genius to know that if you go 10 blocks away to where the black people live, and right now it's less than half a price, and you buy 10 houses there if you have money, all you have to do is to sit 3-4 years and you triple your money. Why? Because it keeps expanding to the minorities area. The Hasidim, they come. Hello, Mr. Williams. How are you? Como esta? Yeah. How much? 450. Come on, I'll give you right now cash, 400. No mortgage, no nothing. You agree? Sign here. What happened? You wait 2-3 years, 400 goes up to a million. Because once it becomes all Hasidish, I don't have to tell you what's going to happen with the demand. This is how people make money. They just see where we're heading. That's it. So there's opportunities. Smart people, they know. I remember 20-something years ago when I passed by Bat Yam in a tayelet by the beach, one of the nicest beaches in Israel. That's where we grew up. They had over there all the buildings, two floors, three floors, all very old, from 1950, 1960, 1970. Very old little motels, all falling apart. All you have to do is to knock down the building and build a nice hotel or something over there. Become a billionaire or residence. I say, if somebody smart will buy all this line, one after the other, buy, knock them all out. Start building buildings over there. 40 floors, 30 floors, hundreds of apartments. Each apartment more than $1 million. That's exactly what someone did. Made fortune over there. Imagine you're in a terrace, you see the beautiful ocean. You breathe the air of the ocean. Beautiful, fancy buildings. He made fortune over there. The land wasn't so expensive. Now it's very expensive. After you made a few nice buildings like this, everything went up, obviously. But this is how people make money. But none of it in America, I'm telling you, it's going to be a disaster. 2019, I'm very scared from what's going to happen. Very, very scared. So most people don't have savings. But those who have savings, they better think about what's going to happen to their money. Because you have to understand, there are Jews here in this country that are so wealthy, they have more than $100 million. Do you know what it means when the dollar go from 3.78 shekel to 3.77? One agora. 1/100 of a shekel. Shekel divided by 100. That's what it is. It's like 2.5 cents. How much is $100 million times 2.5 cents? Huh? How much? $1,250,000 in 1 second. If it goes another agora down, another million down. Shekel, I'm sorry. $1,250,000 shekel, which is about $400,000. In one day, the value of the money goes down. If it will go down to a shekel, $70-80 million they lose. If one day they want to run to Israel, they will be left with nothing. That's what happened to Iran. The Iranian people in the time of the Shah, they will come to New York for a building in Iran. You buy a building in Manhattan. Now, to buy a building in Manhattan, you need 5,000 buildings in Iran to buy one building in Manhattan. For the value of the money. How much is the money worth in Iran? Nothing. There's no value. The reason I'm talking about this is you thinking, I'm just a simple worker, make my living. What do I care about all these millions, billions? That's going to affect your life. What do you think? It's going to affect your mortgage. It's going to affect your health insurance. If the fight between Trump and China will not be resolved, you know what's going to happen? What do you think is going to happen? Right now, you will go to Costco, you want to buy this plastic table. $40, $50. If they won't resolve the issue, you're going to have to buy it made in USA. What do you think? You're going to pay $40 for it? You're going to pay $140 for it. Because in China, you give a worker 50 cents a day. In America, you give a worker $150 a day. Somebody has to pay it. They build it into the price. Everything will become 10 times more. Furniture, leather couches. You go, you buy in Costco leather couch, $700. Made in China. Now if it's going to be made in USA, it's going to be $4,000 a couch. Everything will be 10 times more. They already have 10% tax on import from China before the war even started. 10% extra now. These people who import from China, every container they bring now, they have to pay 10%. It's millions of dollars. 10% of it, it's hundreds of thousands of dollars fees they pay. Because of Trump fighting with China on the trade. And these people, these business people that brings all this stuff, what do you think? They have to raise the prices to the store, who raise the price to us. As it is, we cannot make a living here. With the price of the yeshivot, and the price of the food, and the price of the health insurance. It's a disaster. That's why if Mashiach doesn't come, who knows what would happen? Who knows? One good news we have you know, when the economy collapsed, the ones that pay the price are always the Jews. The Jews, it's called in Hebrew, Sa'ir La'azazel. You know what Sa'ir La'azazel? It's an expression, but you know what it means? In Yom Kippur, what, a scapegoat? Scaper. In Yom Kippur, you have two goats. Korban Echad La'ashem, Korban Echad La'azazel. You know what Azazel means? You take him from the clip, you push him, he falls all the way down to the rocks, crushed to pieces, that's it. That's kapara on Am Israel on Yom Kippur. So they go in, they're looking for someone like this to blame and to kill. When business is bad and the Jews have property, the goyim goes crazy. So there is one good news that I heard. The Congress gave Trump 90 days to assign a minister to fight anti-Semitism in America. They admit that anti-Semitism is on the rise. They have to do something about it because they already know the government. If we're not going to stop it now by giving big punishments and being very tough with this kind of Nazis, they call themselves white nationalists. They found a way, instead of saying Nazi, they found a way. White nationalist. Why? It can be interpreted in two different ways. I'm a proud nationalist. I love America. No, that's not what it means. That means you hate Jews and you hate black people and you hate everyone that is not Aryan, like the Nazis hated. So somebody will give him the money to fight anti-Semitism, to pass laws, to fight all these racist goyim. Don't really count on it. These things is not decided by government. It's not decided by people. This is 100% Hashem decision. Hashem decide when the goyim will come to bite us. He decide when the animals bite us, and when the goyim would bite us, and when the Arab would shoot rocket at us. This is all Hashem. But he used them as a tool, that's all. 100%. This upcoming parasha, Parashat Beshalach, Paro is throwing away from his country the Erev Rav. Vayi Beshalach Paro et Ha'am. Hashem did not. Hashem is the one who sent the nation of Israel out of Mitzrayim, not Paro. Paro refused. But the Torah says, Vayi Beshalach Paro et Ha'am. Right? Well, who's the Am? The Erev Rav. Paro says, oh, you're betraying us? You're joining the enemies of our country as they leave our country and they are being released from slavery? No problem. You don't deserve to be here. Pack your stuff and leave. They leave anyway. Like they say, get out of here. You know, like when someone says, I'm leaving. Leave now. Because when a husband and wife fight, it's very common now in America. Get out of here. Pack your stuff and leave. Sure, I'm going to leave. Of course I'm going to leave. No, leave now. Not another hour. Why? Because he wants to say the last word. And she wants to say the last word. And when the ego comes into the picture, they destroy themselves. Destroy themselves. Someone asked me today about a fight that they had with a teacher of their child in school. I say this. The teacher answered this, I say that, the teacher answered that, 100 times, back and forth. So I ask myself, maybe it's better to send the parents also to kindergarten, to sit next to their children, because they behave like children. So I say, the best idea that I can give you is, send them an apology email. Even if it's 90% their fault, and 10% your fault, You wanna make Hashem happy? Send an apology letter. I'm sorry that things went out of control. I had no intention to hurt you. I hope you have in your heart to forgive me. But for me today, it's very easy anymore because I'm past that childish behaving. I also had it when I was younger. No, Ma, he's gonna tell me what to do. I'll teach him a lesson. When you become old, your hair become white, and you learn a lot of Torah, you know, it gets you nowhere. In Israel, they had a brilliant commercial on television. Guess what the commercial was about? about driving on a road. They had a nice thing. What did they say? Bakvish, al tiye tzodek, tiye chacham. Translation, on the road, don't be right, be smart. You can be right, but you'll be dead. I have the right to go first. Yeah, Tony will get up his gun and shoot your head. Or push you with his truck off the road. Or block you and take his baseball bat and break your head and your car. Every minute in America it happens. Crazy people on the road, drug addict, drunk people, gangster, gang, terrorist. Didn't you see what happened to the Hasid in Borough Park when the Muslim almost killed him on the street? And the Jewish Hasidic judge released that Muslim. It was not hate crime. No, it was a love crime. The Muslim mamash in love with this Hasid. He wanted to marry him. Maybe you marry my daughter Fatma Mendel. Maybe, oh, I love you so much, let me break your head. It was not hate crime. You know, it's the difference between regular vandalism or violence to when you scream a racist remark. It's 10 times more on the punishment. Here you're going to have 6 months service in a hospital, and here you can be 6-7 years in prison, 10 years in prison. Serious prison. That's it. מהרסייך ומחריבייך ממך יצאו. Hashem does not want the Jewish people to go through Egypt, through the Philistines, I'm sorry. Why? He can destroy the Philistines, but the Philistines, their verdict in last Rosh Hashanah was not to die. If the Jews will go through them, they come to a war, I'm going to be forced to kill them. Right now I'm busy with killing the Egyptians and bringing my children into Israel. I do not want to take them from Gaza. I'll take them around. But the Torah gives a very strange excuse, because if they see that the Philistines come to fight them, they will turn back and return to Auschwitz. Do you really believe it would happen? Do you think it was possible that the Jews will turn around and go back to Paro? Paro! Ha, you missed us? We came back. Prepare the mangal, the grill, the steak, the Persian rice, lahmajin, kubbe. We came back. What happened? You came back. After you killed us all, you came back? We missed the eggplant and the zucchini and the watermelons. Do you really think psychologically the Jews will have the guts to go back? Huh? What do you think? It's like a husband who keeps telling his wife, I'm going to divorce you, I'm going to divorce you, I'm going to throw you. And as soon as one day she comes and says, listen, I decided that we should take a break. No, what? It was all talk. Everyone is a macho man until you expose his bluff. Yes, that's it. Moshe is going to search for the bones of Yosef. Yosef's body, the Egyptian threw it into the Nile. The Egyptian thought, if when Yosef was alive, he was in the house of Potiphar, Potiphar became so wealthy and so successful, and the Torah said that the reason that Hashem blessed this goy is because Yosef is working for him as a servant. So imagine if a righteous, holy Jew is working for a filthy goy, rasha, murderer, gay, what else? The worst goy you can imagine. And the goy get a special blessing for Hashem, not because he likes him, he can't stand him. But he gives him the blessing because Yosef lives in his house. Why? What's the connection? You want to benefit Yosef? Kill him. Let Yosef become the master of the house. Why? What's the point of blessing him, making him a billionaire? He was a millionaire, you make him a billionaire. How does it help Yosef? He's still a servant for $10 an hour. Not even. How does it help Yosef? No. Why Hashem found such logic to give the goy? If I went to work in the house of Yasser Arafat, Now he deserves to make, instead of 40 million, 400 million? Because the religious Jew work and serve tea over there? Deserve or no?
Of course.
No. Definitely not. So what, we know better than Hashem? No, now let's see if you're clever. Why Hashem blessed that guy? Why? Hashem made him successful. Why? But what's the connection? Yosef was there.
He's going to act nice to Yosef. He gave him power because he knows the brachas from him.
To pay him back for the little
gift. To teach the world and to write it in the Torah later on that everything in the world begins and ends with the Jewish people. Everything. Everything else is totally secondary. Everything, the world is for the Jews, the Torah is for the Jews, everything is for the Jewish people. If you smart goy, jump on a wagon. What can I do for you, Mr. Jew? Yes. Look at the history. Those who were good to the Jews and those who went against the Jews, how they all ended. Every country the Jewish people lived in, they were the most successful country in the world. Russia, until the Jews left, they collapsed. Communism collapsed. Iran, it was paradise. The Jews left, Khomeini came, Jews ran away, Iran collapsed financially. Spain, Portugal, Rome, Babylon, everywhere the Jews lived, blessing, Germany. Jews living or they kill the Jews, one of the two. Once the Jews are not there, the blessing of the place is gone with them. Check in history. United States, paradise of business, no? What's going to happen if the Jews will have to get up and leave because of the anti-Semitism? Do you know there are countries like Uzbekistan, Portugal, Spain, begging the Jews to come back? Do you know that? Do you know Spain and Portugal advertising Israeli television? Come and get a Portuguese passport. You will be a European citizen. They'll give you rights in all the banks in Europe. You'll be able to trade with Euro. You're not going to need visa. They tried to convince the Jews to come back. They got the point 500 years later that since the Jews left, 500 years they are in the mud. Uzbekistan, one Bukharian guy came to me. Said to me, they beg the Jews, the Muslims, to come back. The days when you lived here was paradise. Beg them to come back. The government, come, we'll help you. Open business, do something.
Russia, too.
Russia, I don't know Russia, but...
Pay money to come back.
To come back. Here you go. Here you go. Why? The goyim, some of them... Get the point. As soon as the Jews left, remember, these goyim read the Torah in their churches. The priest, the father is teaching them what the Torah say, and they read. What do you think? They're dumb. They read that Hashem bless the Jews. I chose you from all the nation to be my children. But the interesting thing is that two goyim interpret the Torah completely opposite than each other. One guy, when he reads in the Torah that God loves the Jews and he blesses them and everything is for the Jews, he immediately says, I have to be a Jew, I have to love the Jews. Ma, everything is from the Jews. Even JC came from the Jews. That's one kind of goyim. And then you have the other kind of goyim. Oof, these Jews, everything is them. I can't, we have to kill them, we can't live with them. It's from the same Torah. One chooses, you know what, I have to support and love the Jews because God loved them. I remember one time I went to buy a car in an auction with a friend of mine that was a car dealer. I was standing over there. One guy, dressed like a soldier, you know, this uniform, came to me. I don't know him, Bichlan. He said to me, I want to ask you a question. No, mamash, like this. I'm standing in the auction waiting. Yes. Tell me, what does the Palestinian want from you? Don't they read in the Torah, in the Bible, he said, that God loves you, and you are the chosen people, and without you, this world does not have an existence. Don't they get it? Don't they see that God gave you the Holy Land? Goy. American Goy. Some of them get the point. Most of them don't. That's why you have anti-Semitism. Technically, if you go to a school and one of the children in your class is the son of the king, the prince, do you want to make him your enemy and hit him and spit at him and do all kinds of things to upset him? Or you want to be his best buddy, help him, hug him, kiss him, do his homework for him, ask him if he can come to your house for the weekend? What is the right approach? If you be friendly with the prince, and you be nice to him, and you save him from the bullying and all kinds of other things in school, who would love you automatically? His father. You'll be a VIP in a palace. And if you hit him and curse him and do bad things to him, who will hate you the most? The king. And when the king hates you, what happened to you? You are finished. So why these Arabs don't get it? Why these anti-Semite Nazis don't get it? The answer is they can't get it. Because Hashem needs them to go against us. It's a part of Hashem's agenda. The goyim, they are blinded by Hashem. They can't see that. Why? Because if all the goyim would admire us and love us and say, oh, you're the chosen people, and a Jew come, everyone rise. Come, Mr. Son of God. What can we do for you? What do you think would happen after 2-3 generations? There would be no Jews left. All the Jews would marry the goyim. They're so nice to us, such great people. They're loving us, they're protecting us, they respect us like gods. Come, marry my daughter, I'll give you everything you want, business, house, I'll pay everything. Just agree to marry Christine, such a nice girl, we all love you. 2-3 generations, it will be all over. Now, at least we have what to be afraid of. Imagine you marry a goya. First of all, you have to be smart to know that this love will not remain forever, this temptation you have, I mean, desire, whatever you want to call it.
Passion.
Second thing is, he will die out after a few months, but there's a bigger problem than this. Soon Christmas is coming, came. And you're going to have to sit in a table with our father, and he's going to go like this, "Dear Lord, in the name of the father and his grandfather and his aunt, the triangle." That's what he's going to say. And you're going to have to sit there and see JC hang like this on a cross and this and the bush over there blinding you with the lights. And then 2-3 years later, you're going to have a little Johnny comes home. "Hi, Dad. What did you buy me for Christmas?" You're going to have to live with that. They're going to come to you for Passover night. "Hey, Itzik, hi. We heard tomorrow you're celebrating the Seder night. What should we bring for dinner?" "Huh? What should we bring?" You have to come and sit in your table. And they're going to start telling you all kinds of verses from JC and from Matthew and John and Luke. "I heard in the church, Father such and such say such and such." That's what's going to happen. And they are nice people. Not necessarily bad people. To be very nice people, but they're talking to you Avodah Zarah, idol worshipping. They worship a human being. They don't even know, by the way, what he is. Every one of them thinks something else. Ask them, what was he, son of God or the Messiah? Or both? You're going to hear different opinions. Different opinions. So, now, why Moshe is the leader of the Jewish nation has to deal with looking for the body of Yosef that the Egyptians threw it into the Nile, that the Nile will be blessed. If you're a king, take a team of 5-6 people, you, and you, go and search for the body of Yosef. Me? I'm the king. I have to go and what should I dive? Maybe I put oxygen balloon and dive in the Nile. And Yosef, where are you? They didn't never have Netanelli back then. We have in Los Angeles a very holy man. You tell him if someone is missing, he'll tell you where he is. One person told me, testified to me, that somebody went lost in a river in Los Angeles somewhere. The police, 48 hours, look for him with helicopters, projectors, this, commando, SEAL, whatever you want. Couldn't find the body. He said, we went to the rabbi. He told me to do certain things, to put a bread inside a jar, put it on the water, and say all kinds of words. And where it's going to go, and it's going to stand over there, that's where you go. You dive over there, you find him over there. And that's exactly what happened after the police gave up already. Police, you know, they search for X amount of time. After that, they drop the case. You have to invest everything you have to look for someone who's disappeared. Hundreds of thousands of people in America are missing. Do you know that? Missing. Nobody knows where they are. Somebody kidnapped them when they're children or prostitute. Do you know how many Ukraine and Russian women are kidnapped right now all over the world? Hidden in some basement with bars. They took away their passport. They forced them to work in prostitution. And they don't see the daylight for 20 years. Do you know how many? Hundreds of thousands. Ukraine, Russian, from all that area. They advertise. You make $2,000 a month. Very big money for them. What? Cleaning lady, taking care of elder people. That's what they tell them. As soon as they arrive to Europe or to Israel or to Greece or to all these countries that has a lot of prostitution by tourists and all kinds of things like this, they take away their passport. It's mafia people. They force her into some bedroom under the ground somewhere. 20 years now. She has a husband, children, waiting for her to go work for a year or 6 months and come back. And she never see a daylight anymore. Nobody looks for them. Nobody knows where they are. Like this. In Israel, you have thousands of them. Prostitution every block, every building, their own apartments. In every building, not every, but in many of the buildings, you come, one, two apartments, belongs to the Russian mafia. Russian mafia. In Israel, Christian, Cossacks, came to Israel 15, 20 years ago, ran away from Russia. The stupid Israeli government gave them $15,000 to each immigrant. And they came to Israel. They made Christian cemeteries. 150 pork stores in every city in average. Pork stores, shrimps, rabbits they sell. Everywhere you go. Terrible. And when they murder, oh my gosh. These people have no soul. Mamash like Nazis. This Ukrainian, Hashem Yirachem, the cases of murder that happen in Israel, a lot of them are hitmen, for hire. Have no mercy. Women, children, they chop them to pieces. How they kill. You cannot believe it. And they brought 800,000 of them into Israel. This is what Trump is trying to prevent in this country. In Mexico, you drive in the middle of the day, someone is hanged on a light. You're looking for a green light. You look up, you see someone is hanged there. In the middle of the night, they hang him on a light in the middle of the intersection. I had a host in Mexico when I was there. I told him, tell me, do you hear about this cartel, all the gun shooting, killing, massacre people? He said, where we live, we don't hear it. We, the Syrian community over there in Mexico City, we don't get it so much. But we definitely have to watch our children, some of the rich people that need bodyguards. Your child is in a class, there's bodyguards outside. Because they want to kidnap them. They're going to get $3 million for them. In Mexico, $3 million is like $30 million a year. So if you have a rich kid, every second of your life you have to live with the fear that one day they'll kidnap him, and it happened hundreds of times. So I asked him, what's the worst thing you ever seen? He said, one morning I took my kids to yeshiva, I look at the light, I see someone is hanged there with a rope. On the light, 7 o'clock in the morning. this is what's going on. Crazy. So now the question is, Moshe could have sent the team to look for Yosef. Why did not want to do it? Who knows?
It's his own chiyuv. He wanted to do it himself.
Why? It's not his chiyuv. Moshe is considered a Kohen. Kohen should not go after dead bodies. If you're a Kohen, you cannot walk in Atzala and places like this. You sit in an ambulance, the person will die. What are you going to do? It makes you impure. You cannot go into hospitals. It's a big problem. Kohen goes into hospital for sure. There's dead body there, or here and there, in a free refrigerator, in one of the rooms. Every hour someone died there. It's a big problem. Kohen cannot get on a plane. He needs to check if they're not delivering a dead body to Israel. Kohen cannot fly above cemeteries of Jews. If he knows the Jewish cemeteries that the plane fly above it, it's a big problem. The impurity goes unlimited all the way up of the dead bodies of the Jewish people. That's why El Al, they have special routes that they're not flying above certain cities and places. That's what someone told me a few years ago. And a lot of, many times, Kohanim has a flight and they notify them. We had an emergency to take a dead body to a funeral. We'll put you on the next flight. Not easy to be a Kohen. Not easy. In the old days, at least the Kohanim used to get 10% from all the nation. Income coming in. You don't have to worry. You focus on the holy services. Today, they don't get 10%. What do they get? They have a lot of edek. Birkat Kohanim, keep taking the shoes, going up, going down, washing your hands. All these things. There's a lot of limitation, cannot marry a divorcee. A lot of Kohanim stay single just because of that. They cannot find a worthy woman. She has to be single. She cannot be divorced. And she can never, it's not a girl that never been with a goy. In America, if you are 30, 35, you need to find a girl in your age, 30, 31, 29, that she was never married and never been with a goy in her life. Very difficult. That's why a lot of Kohanim can't find shiduch. Big problems. Very big problems. So the answer is, Moshe could not send them because Hashem sent them to collect money from the Egyptians. Divrei Arav veDivrei HaTalmid, Divrei Mi Nishmaim. If your rabbi told you go right, and his student told you go left, who should you listen to? The rabbi. Hashem is the rabbi, Moshe is the student. If Hashem say to them, now I have to keep my promise to Avraham Avinu, go to the Egyptians, I make the Egyptian that you find favor in their eyes. For few hours, it's your chance right now. Go collect jewelry, collect gold, collect everything you can, clothing. The Egyptians will give you. So they are going to keep the mitzvah of Hashem. It's mitzvah that Hashem said to go do it. So Moshe said, how can I tell them not to go first? I deprive them. It's not fair. Everybody collect wealth and they're going to go look for Yosef's body. How can I do it to them? Second, even if I want to do it, it's against what Hashem said. So Moshe went and did it. The question is like this. The Gemara in Masechet Sota, page 13, also in Midrash Tanchuma, the Chazal speaks about it in the Zohar also. They said, it's written in Mishlei. What's Mishlei? Proverbs. King Solomon. In the book of Mishlei, one of the three books that connects to Shlomo HaMelech, King Solomon, chapter 10, verse 8. It's written, Chacham Lev Ikach Mitzvot. Chacham Lev, smart heart, will grab mitzvot. Do you know, in the Torah, it's nothing if you have a sharp head. Nothing. If you're a brilliant head, you're very sharp, you're very smart, you understand everything quickly. Best mathematician in the world, great computer engineer, people with head, great professor, whatever you want to call it. It's zero in the eyes of Hashem. You don't get any credit for it. I gave you a sharp brain. What, you're trying to impress me? Nowhere in the Torah Hashem gives any credit for intelligence. And when you are smart, meaning you have a sharp head, the Torah always speaks about smart heart, chacham lev, mileti et libo chokhma. There is good hearts and bad hearts. The heart of Paro, bad heart. Lev Paro, terrible heart. The heart of Moshe, great heart. The heart of David HaMelech, great heart. Like it's written in Pirkei Avot, Lev Tov. Lev Tov is the most desirable thing that a person should have. If you have a good heart, it's very easy to work with you. Very easy. You have a hard, evil heart, Shem Yirachem. How difficult everything goes with you. It's written in the Torah, when Mashiach come, I will replace your heart of stone with a heart of flesh. Meaning from the verses of the Torah, you find that cruelty and evilness and ungratefulness and jealousy and stubbornness, this is all coming from the heart. Now remember, the heart is the container of all the blood. The blood goes inside constantly, pumping blood to all the body. It's a pump. What makes the blood, what creates blood in a body? Food. The food we eat. You don't eat, you have no blood. You eat liver, you get blood. You eat what do you call this red? Beets. Beets, it's good for the heart. There's all kinds of food, vegetables, it's good for the heart. For the blood, I mean. There is even one Italian doctor that wrote a book, Eat According to Your Blood Type. He claimed, and it sounds very convincing, that every person has a blood type. A, B, AB, all kinds of blood. I don't know really the difference between them, but the doctor will tell you. He said that all the general statements of people that teach all kinds of diets are all incorrect. Why? Because when they tell you, stay away from meat, it's not true. For some people it's bad, for some people it's very good. Stay away from chicken, for some people it's good, for some people it's bad. Don't eat this, don't eat eggs, don't eat that. It's all generalizing. Eat according to your blood type. And he said the story that he was in a hospital in New York, and there was one rabbi, I think it was in Borough Park, Maimonides, one rabbi dying, old man, and the rabbi sent reading Tehillim there, and he passed by this goy doctor, goy. He said, what happened to your husband? She said, the doctor said this, he looks at everything. He said, what type of blood he has? He looked, he said, listen, tell your husband in the next 2 weeks not to eat any five kinds of grains. Not to touch wheat, barley, oats, spelt and rye. For 2 weeks. No spaghetti, no cornflakes, no none of this. For 2 weeks it will be fine. What be fine? The doctor said it's a matter of days, that's it. 2 weeks not to touch these things, everything will be fine. He got up after 2 weeks like a brand new person. Came out of the hospital. He brings the whole story there. And he said that certain food, it's poison for certain type of blood, but it's great for other type of blood. So you see, the blood is a lot more than what we know. A lot more. You know, in Israel, you have a special bank of blood. Special. Only for Shomrei Shabbat. If you are Shomer Shabbat, and one day, God forbid, you're going to need blood transfusion, you don't want to accept blood from a secular Jew or from a non-Jew. Because they eat non-kosher food. And the non-kosher food is the one who creates the blood. So the blood is contaminated spiritually. It affects the soul. Remember, the soul is in the brain. The blood, the heart, sends blood into the brain. That's what keeps the soul inside the body. If you're going to take 5 liters of blood out of the person, that second the soul leaves out. As a matter of fact, when a person bleeds to death, every drop of blood that goes out of his body, a drop of the soul leak out of the body as well. It's written clearly in the Torah, ki adam hu ha-nefesh. The blood is the soul. The blood is connecting the soul into the body. It's the nefesh. That's why when we slaughter the animals, right away we have to throw a lot of salt to get out the blood out of the system. Then we rinse it. We're not allowed to eat the blood of the animals because this is the nefesh of the animal. It's affecting us spiritually. That's why a lot of people that eat not kosher behave like animals. And if you find religious people that behave like animals, it's also because they eat not kosher. Either the meat they buy, it's fake, it's not really kosher, or the chickens, or they eat a lot of worms. A lot of religious people eat non-stop worms. They go to kosher restaurant, they eat lettuce, broccoli, it's full of worms and bugs. It's very impossible to clean. Impossible. They go to a Persian restaurant. You know how much greens they put? They call it rehun. You heard about it or no? Rehun. You know how many worms and flies they have in lettuce, in rehun, in parsley, in this and that? They use a lot of greens, the Persians. Korean Persians. Big problem. You want to get a toast today. Toast. Pita toast. They put lettuce underneath. Who knows how many microscopic worms in there. A lot of religious people eat non-stop trefot and non-stop shkatzim. Shkatzim. Very much. Very possible. So don't be surprised. So Moshe is following this pasuk. Chacham lev ikach mitzvot. Meaning, when the nation of Israel were busy in taking all the wealth out of Egypt, Moshe was busy with the mitzvah of looking for the body of Yosef. Two things we have to ask. Bizat ha-Mitzrayim was also a mitzvah. Hashem say to clean Mitzrayim from all the wealth. That's also a mitzvah. Mitzvah to take care of a dead body, to bring it to a burial, and mitzvah to listen to Hashem and go get the jewelry of the Egyptians before we leave Egypt. So that's question number one. Question number two. Why Moshe had to wait until all the Jewish people went to ask from the Egyptian to give them the wealth, and that's only then he went to look for the body of Yosef? Why didn't he do it before? He waited until everybody went. Hey, Ahmed. Give me your jewelry. Hey, Mustafa. Hi. I'm Itzik. Nice to meet you. Yalla, give me all your diamonds. That's what happened. The Jews came. You have to give us some things. We work here for you for over 80 years. Give us something. And the Egyptian, Hashem made the Jews find favors in the eyes of the Egyptians. So from here you learn that if people like you or hate you, it's also because of what Hashem decides. Some people, they don't speak a word. They annoy you. Some people, right away, fall in love with him. Don't understand why. Oh, I love this guy. You see it. Make a survey. Take one person, take another person. Take 100 people. Ask them, who do you like more? Don't make them say a word just by looking at them. This guy, 80% love him. This guy, only 20% love him. Unbelievable. So, what's going on here? So, we see right away that the question that we have to ask is why Moshe needed to wait until they all went and then he went to look for the body of Yosef. The answer is, Rabotai, because Moshe was a Kohen. Kohen is not allowed to take care of a body unless what? Unless there's nobody else to do the mitzvah. It's called met mitzvah. If there's nobody, then you're allowed. While they were still around, he couldn't do it. He had to wait until they all go and busy with the mitzvah of Hashem. Now I have my obligation, let me go and take care of the body of Yosef. They're all busy. And Moshe went and found the body with the help of Serach Bat Asher. And they brought Yosef and they buried him where in Israel? In Shechem, Nablus. Shechem, Shechem is the most dangerous city in Israel today. If you go there in 1 hour you're dead. Serious. All Hamas, all crazy terrorists. Huh? Yeah, Muhammad. The Gemara said that Shechem will always be a place of tragedy. Poranuyot. Yosef had problems there with the brothers. All the things, the bad things, Shechem, all the time. Yosef is buried in Shechem. The Muslim stole his grave from us, painted it green like Palestinian color, and we can't even go there. You want to go now to pray in the grave of Yosef? You need the whole Israeli commando to escort you. And they shoot. They already killed a few Breslevs. Breslev, they have a thing to go in the middle of the night to the grave of Yosef. So they take some soldiers, and they themselves have guns, some of them. But still, some of them got killed over the years. They ambush them, and they shoot, and they kill. You want to go pray in the grave of Yosef? You can't. Definitely regular people cannot go there. It's very dangerous. What is the message Hashem sends us by taking away the grave of Yosef from us? Yosef is a symbol of holiness, of someone that was humbled and modest and did not waste seed, did not make sin with the women, kept his brit. That's why Aliyat Shishi, it's Yosef, it's Tikkun HaBrit. Tikkun HaYesod, Yosef is Yesod, the foundation of our nation is modesty. So Yosef is the symbol of holiness and modesty and proper behaving between men and women and all the rest of the sins that we see everywhere we go today. And Hashem said to us, Rabotai, you don't deserve it. Give it to these filthy murderers. Give it to them. Let them have it. You don't deserve it. But why they have it? We don't murder. We don't torture people. We don't slaughter babies in a crib. We don't shoot and pass by citizens. Even when we want to go and retaliate, when they attack us, we throw papers to them. Leave the area before we bomb. We're not animals like them. No, I'm not talking about murders. That's a different category. I'm talking about modesty. Who dress more modest, you or them? You go over there in Shechem, you see a woman with the bikini ever? Huh? Can you find one Fatma with bikini on the street? Naked, all her body is out, tattoos everywhere, earring over here. They used to put earring on the nose of the pigs, you know, as a mark. Or the ear, the mark, all these things with the animal, nezem, or by the slaves. Today it's in fashion. That's the new style now. So Hashem say, what can I do? You are my children. You don't listen to me. You want to live like animals. You behave like animals. You dress like animals. Animals are not dressed. They walk naked. That's what you want to be? You deserve to go to such a holy place, the grave of Yosef? Symbol of not wasting seed, symbol of modesty, symbol of... what's of course not. Let me give it to these murderers. Let me give it to them, to show you that sometimes you behave worse than them. Yes, you're not a filthy murderer like them, but they are as bad as they are, as cruel as they are, as monster as they are. They have more dignity than you. This murderer who slaughter the throat of babies and shoot people and blow their head off and throw people from the fifth floor with no mercy, and go over people's head with a tank, smash them to million pieces. If his wife will show her arm on the street, that'll be the end of her. Think about it, Rabotai. Think about what I'm saying here. Nazis thinking about modesty more than us, religious people with beards, with yarmulke, with tefillin on our hands. Wigs, high heels, short skirt, everything attached. The whole duty free on her before she leaves the house. Now I know what you're thinking, and you're probably right. One person told me, In Iran, everyone cover. As soon as the plane go to Paris, they all take off the show. Tight jeans, this, that. Oh! Mariam became Mary. She's on the way, Marie, she's on the way to Paris. Some of them are like this, not all. Yes, fakers. But at least the streets are clean. At least the children don't have to see naked women all day. At least they embarrass in public to show themselves. Only when they're far away. Still better than us. The truth hurts. What can I do? Believe me, it's the last thing I would like to say in my lecture. The last thing. To give these murderers, these terrorists, to give them any credit? No. I'm not even giving them credit. I'm criticizing ourselves. That these murderers are more modest than us in public. And that's a very, very poor mark to every one of us. Very poor. Especially with only two generations ago, our grandmothers were the most modest you can imagine. Who the Arabs learn modesty from? Who? From who? From Sarah. From Rivka. From Rachel and Leah. From the Torah. From who? How the Arabs learn how to dress and relationship. How the Arabs learn about the concept of getting married or divorce. Where the Goyim learned it from. It's all from the Jews. Very sad. Then the Torah continues. The Torah says, Vayikach 600 rechev bachur. Paro order 600 carriages. Each carriage has one soldier. One Egyptian is standing with a horse, with wheels on the side. Two wheels connect to a horse, and the horse runs very, very fast, like 30, 40 miles an hour with a horse, with a carriage with two wheels. Very fast vehicle. Why 600? Do you know everything that Hashem does is very deep. Why Hashem planted that 600 Egyptians would run after 3 million Jews? What is the ratio between 600 men to 3 million? It's 1 to how much? Huh? 1 to how much? 1 to 5,000. 2 to 10,000. What does the Torah say? Echa irdof echad mikem mea veshnaim yanisu revava. The Torah say, when you listen to me, one of you will chase 100 goyim, one. And two of you will chase 10,000. Listen to this. One chase 100, two should have chased 200. No. Two together, hand to hand, it's much more powerful than 1 plus 1. It's not 100 plus 100. Two together, it's 10,000 already. Do the math. 600, 3 million, 600 goyim, chase 3 million Jews. The other way around. You understand, Rabotai? Hashem is sending a message. You're complaining, but you'll see what I'm going to do to them. What does it mean, Hashem ilachem lachem v'atem tacharishun? Hashem will fight for you. Atem tacharishun means you'll be silent, quiet. What's the connection? You should say, I will fight for you, and you sit still. And you stay home. I get the point. What does it mean I be quiet? Why you don't want me to talk? What's the meaning of the pasuk, Hashem ilachem lachem v'atem tacharishun? Who knows? Atem tacharishun, it means you don't speak against each other. Don't kill each other with your mouth. Lashon hara, gossip. The Gemara says, Chazal explained, in the generation of Achav, they were idol worshippers, very wicked people. But they never turned against each other. They were all wicked, but united. United wicked people. The unity, they always won the war and nobody died. Wicked, idol worshippers, but united. In the generation of King David, they kept all the laws of the Torah. Everyone was extremely religious. But they had between them deltorin. You know what's deltorin? Instigate between each other, fighting, politics, racism, false hatred, sinat chinam. They were losing in a war. Many of them died. This is the power of unity that Hashem loves so much. Then the Torah says, look at the Egyptians for the last time. Because as you see them today, you will never ever see them again. And right after that, contradiction. The Torah says, Vayar Israel et Mitzrayim et Asfat Hayam. The Torah says, look at this Egyptian, soon you will never ever see them again. Meaning, I'm taking you out of Egypt, you don't have to deal with them anymore. Right after that, the Egyptians drowned. They all came out to the shore. And the Jews look at 600 soldiers dead. How does it go together? Two butchers in a business. They were partners, and then they had a fight and they separated. One of them swore, I make a vow that I will never ever look at the face of my ex-partner. After a while, the partner died. And the friend felt bad that he made such a vow. He wanted to go to his funeral. He came to the Natziv. It was a very big rav. He asked him, what should I do? I swore that I will never look at his face. The Natziv said, the answer to your question is in Parashat Beshalach. Looking at the body of a person is not looking at him. It's looking at his body. Looking at a person when the soul is inside, you are looking at a soul, a living soul. The soul came out of the body, it's not a person, it's a piece of meat. So you see from the Torah that Hashem told them, you will never have to look at these Egyptians again. But right after that, they saw the Egyptians dead. From here we learn that when you are dead, you're not what you used to be when you're alive. It's no problem. The vows does not hold. You can go to the funeral. Vayomer Mitzrayim. The Egyptians say, Anusa mipnei bnei Israel ki Hashem nilcham lahem b'mitzrayim. Let's run from these Jews. Because Hashem is fighting for them. It's obvious. We cannot win. What is the difference between Boreach and Nas? Evrach, Anusa. Boreach, Nas. Borchim, Nasim. Bricha, Menusa. What's the difference? Nas is running away and Boreach is running away. But there has to be a difference between them. There's not two words that are different and actually similar. The answer is, Rabotai, when you run, livroach, it means you run temporarily, but you're about to come back. You run from your house because a murderer is going with a gun and shooting. So you run away to the forest, but in 2-3 hours, when the police will arrest him, you will come back. That's called livroach. Nas al nafsho. Nas means with no intention to come back. Forever. Run away from America, from the FBI. Where? Ran away to Morocco. Why Morocco? Very good. The FBI's arm does not reach the Moroccan. They don't like spicy food. Too much matbucha and harif. The Moroccan say to, hey Steve, stay in New York. Over here, it's a different world. By the way, I don't know, I know one Jew that did some fraud in the market, ran away to Morocco, and a few months later, the FBI caught him in Morocco. So maybe the news that they cannot catch people in Morocco, the Moroccan will not turn him in, maybe it's not so precise. Because the wife of that person, I asked her, how is he in jail? He ran away to Morocco, he said. No, she said, yeah, the FBI got him in Morocco. Don't ask me how. We all know that the CIA and the FBI not always following the instructions 100%, without going into details. So, we got the point. Many people ask, why the Jewish people did not sing when Hashem strike the Egyptian with 10 plagues? Why they only sang after they came out of the Red Sea? But why when Hashem destroyed the Egyptian, every house people fall and die, everything became blood and frogs and their animals died and Egypt is destroyed? Why they did not sing in Egypt? Why did they have to wait? We have to understand, the Egyptians were beaten in front of the eyes of the Jewish nation. They should have at least sang a song to Hashem after Makat Bechorot. When they were released from slavery, they say a song to Hashem. The Torah says, when your enemies collapse, don't be happy. Binfol oyvecha al tismach, uvekoshlo al yagel libecha. When your enemy fell, don't rejoice. When King Solomon wrote it, who did he have in mind? Which enemies? If a Palestinian murderer who came to kill us got electrocuted by the fence and died, and we got saved, are we allowed to sing and make a party and open a good bottle of whiskey and say, L'chaim, thank you, Hashem? Or that's breaking the rules? What does it mean when your enemy collapses? Is that means my enemy, a Jewish enemy that opened a store across the street for me? Competition? So even though he did something very bad, Hashem punished him and he went bankrupt. Is that what it means, that I should not be happy when he has to close the store and put a sign closed? That what the Torah said, don't be happy? Or when the Nazi got caught, Eichmann, and they killed him, also don't be happy? What do you think? Huh? Something so important and you don't know? So what do? When an Arab Hamas terrorist got shot, you happy or you're not happy? Do you say, Shtabach Shemo? Let's drink L'chaim. Great job, the soldiers. L'chaim. Why L'chaim? You're not allowed to be happy, no? The answer is only Jewish enemy. Not enemies that wants to destroy us. Mitzvah to make a party when they die. Of course. If all the Nazis would be dead, we should make a very big party. Kill millions of us and we're not going to be happy? If you're not happy, you're not a human being. You're not normal. If you said that Hitler died, something about you is not normal. But you have a Jew that have Yetzer Hara, he's looking for Parnassah, he opened a business across the street. That's not fair, what he did. It's a dirty move. But now he's paying for his sin. Look, he lost $200,000, business is closed. Think about his wife, children. Why are you happy? You happy that Hashem punished a Jew? All of you are pieces from the same puzzle. What is it like that your right hand is happy that your left hand broke? So now you're going to use the right hand more. It's great. My competition died. You fool, it's all one body. Kol Yisrael arevim zeh lazeh. Vayosha Hashem bayom ahu. Et Israel miad Mitzrayim. Hashem saved at that day the Jewish nation from the hands of the Egyptians. And Israel saw Mitzrayim dead on the shore. Vayar Israel et hayad hagdola asher asa Hashem b'mitzrayim. The nation of Israel saw the great hand of Hashem, what he did in Egypt. Vayireu ha'am et Hashem vayaminu b'Hashem. The nation feared God and believed in God and in Moshe his servant. Fear God, believed in God, and in Moshe his servant. Meaning what Moshe promised really happened in the name of God. So they are a good team. Moshe is not making it up. Okay, so he's reliable. So we rely on Moshe because he's reliable. Of course, we rely on God that is his rabbi. And we fear God. Why we fear God? He's on our side. What are you afraid of? Your father. Afraid of your father? No. Why are you afraid of Hashem? Why? After you saw he destroyed Egypt. You see when you mess with Hashem, what's your end? Make sure I don't do the same thing they did. The deeds, the acts of the Egyptians in Egypt do not dare to do. Why? Soon we will see why. Next thing, Az Yashir Moshe. The Gemara say, don't say Yashir, say Yudshir. Yud is 10. 10 songs legendary people sang to Hashem in history. 9 actually. The 10th one will be by Mashiach. Shiru LaHashem Shir Chadash. All the Shirim in the Torah, it's in a female language. Shir, Shira Chadasha, Shira Yafa, Tashira Zot. Shiru LaHashem Shir Chadash, not Chadasha. Chadash, that's different than the other 9. Why? All the 9 is before Mashiach. Chadash is after Mashiach, which will be very soon. We have a few problems here. How can you say song? We have a rule that you don't say a song on a miracle that happened out of Israel. Did you know that? Wow. You don't say a song on a miracle that Hashem did out of Israel. That's why we don't say Hallel in Purim. Did you ever wonder how can we not say Hallel? Almost all of us died in Persia. We got saved from Haman. What can be bigger Hallel than this? How come we don't say Hallel in the day of Purim? We say Al HaNisim, but we don't say Hallel. The answer is Hallel is singing. And the miracle was in Persia, out of Israel. The Red Sea, it's not Israel, from the direction they came. Some say that before they enter Israel, they could sing. The rule did not apply. Meaning, before you enter Israel for the first time, all over the world you had to sing. Now, after you already upgraded to the level of living on the Holy Land, and there's a miracle out of Israel, you cannot sing. Because it's not the same like we are now in Israel. That's a greater level. It makes a lot of sense. That's why the 900 years later, the miracle happened in Persia, but there are Jews in Israel already, before. Shlomo HaMelech said, when your enemy collapses, don't be happy. Proverbs 24:17. How they so happy that the enemies collapse? There's a difference. When the angels wanted to sing, Hashem said to them, my hand's creation is drowning in the ocean and you want to sing? The answer is, the angels cannot sing because they are a part of the creation. What are you happy? What you created is breaking to pieces. You're happy about your creation is falling apart. But the Jewish people, they must be happy. They must sing when the wicked murderers are dying. By the way, some Jews, when they collapse, it's mitzvah to be happy also. If you watch my Way of the Righteous series, I brought you sources over there, at least 8 or 9 or 10 even, places that proves Be'avod Reshaim Rina. When these liberal lefty traders like George Soros and few other wicked Jews are dying, mitzvah to be happy and to say, Imach Shimam. And when they are alive, you have to say, Shem Reshaim Yirkav. Rav Avigdor Miller has a whole big, long, nice answer about it. Of course it's mitzvah to denounce them. Of course, these are the enemies of God in every second of their life. These are the destroyers of the Torah. These are the destroyers of the Jewish ideology. These are the traitors who, because of them, many of us died and our children are dying. Because they help our enemies to kill us faster. How many of the Jews in America are in this category? How many? We have an exact number. How many? Who knows? 75%. Correction, 69%. How do we know? First election, 75% voted for Hussein Obama. But we can give them the benefits of the doubt because they didn't know who is involved here, even though, you know, there was already some red lights before. But they wanted to give it a chance. Give peace a chance. Second election, 69% voted again for Hussein Obama. 6% realized their mistake. So they're out of the category of the Erev Rav. So we have 69% of the Jews in America voted Hussein Obama. They claim that there are 6 million Jews in America. Probably not all of them voting, no? Not everyone ran to vote. So let's say half went to vote. Take off children, take off very old people. Maybe 3 million went to vote. Based on this ratio, 70% of 3 million is 2.1 million people. 2.1 million enemies of the state of Israel, supporters of Iran, supporters of gay parades, supporters of gay marriage, enemies of the Torah, hate religious people, hate God, hate everything in Judaism, hate their identity, change their Jewish name to all kinds of goyish names. Many of them refuse to put mezuzot and to circumcise their children. Not to talk about, not to keep any mitzvah, of course. This is the situation here in America, based on their statistic. Based on their statistic. Really, the truth is that it's more than 2 million. Because even those who did not go to vote, if the ratio is 69%, it's 69% from 6 million. That's a lot worse. It's 4.2 million people. Assuming they're all Jewish. Because the majority of them are not Jewish according to the halakha, if you know what I mean. 6, 7, or 8 generations, their mother and grandmother and grandmother, they're all merry goyim. And the grandparents, merry goyot. So many of them came out of non-Jewish girls. So they are not really Jewish. I once explained that even the prime minister of Israel, the famous Ariel Sharon, was not Jewish. The Minister of Defense, Rafael Etan, Raful, was not Jewish. Why? His mother was not Jewish. Father was Jewish. Sharon. Sharon is a Jewish name. But the mother was Vera from Russia, Goya. Vera. Prime Minister of Israel that gave his life to defend the land until the last 5 years of his life when he took everything and gave it to the Palestinians, Hamas, as a gift. It turned 180 degrees. But most of his life he was a warrior and a soldier and a proud Jew, a proud Israeli, a proud Zionist. And he wasn't even Jewish. That's what's going on today.
Vera.
Vera. Vera with hay, not with ayin. Don't add more oil to the fire. There's enough oil, don't worry. There's enough oil. Ay, 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 ay. Good question. Why they didn't sing in the middle of the Makot?
That's your question?
Yeah, not my question. Chachamim asked the question. The answer is because they did not believe that this salvation is permanent. They still thought, that's here he brings the answer, they still thought that they're going to chase us and bring us back. So what's the point of singing when the miracle is incomplete yet? Once the miracle will be complete, then we sing. By the way, you should know one thing. The miracle of Egypt, was it ever completed or no? No. Until today, we still suffer. Until today, the Goyim are after us. Until today, not all the Jews live in Israel. Until today, we don't have freedom from the Goyim. So what kind of salvation it was? The answer is, the Gemara said, when Mashiach comes, the holidays will not have the same weight like now. Why? What do you need Rosh Hashanah for? There's no more judgment. There's no more Yetzer Hara. No Yetzer Hara, no more test. Hashem eliminated the Satan. Nobody will have evil inclination. Everyone would love Torah and mitzvot and chesed. Nobody would lie. Nobody would steal. Nobody would sleep. There's not going to be fatigue. There's not going to be any of that. Nobody will run after food. Remember, we will not have Yetzer Hara. What do we need Rosh Hashanah? Besides celebrating that it used to be the judgment day. That's not going to be so relevant. Same thing Yom Kippur. What do you need repentance for? You don't make any intentional sins anymore. What do you need Passover for? The salvation of Passover compared to the salvation of Mashiach, it's like comparing a silver coin to a big diamond. Silver coin to a big diamond. Right now, that's all we have. We have that silver coin. We're holding to it. As soon as we're going to get that diamond, what's going to happen to the silver coin? Throw it in the drawer for 10 years. You don't open the drawer. What happened? It was so precious. It was precious that I did not have anything else. Now when Mashiach came, all the wicked Goyim are all dead. All the wicked Jews are all dead. And there's no more wars. And there's no more antisemitism. And there's no more babies are born. And there's no more autistic and Down syndrome and handicaps and all kinds of cancer and problems and divorce. None of this will appear. That's it. It's all over. All the nightmare of this world will end completely. The lion will be next to the goat. It's going to be harmony all over. All the nations will put off their army, eliminate their army. You're not going to need to beg North Korea, please, please, I'm begging you. What's his name? Kim? Come on, I thought we became friends. No, you're ruining me. One is a liar. Yeah, yeah, we'll put off our nuclear. What nuclear? They keep building and doing. It's all a show. They know America, it's called Namer Shel Niyar. You know what's Namer Shel Niyar? A leopard that made out of paper. It's an Israeli expression. Namer Shel Niyar means you only bark, but you cannot bite. Well, it makes a lot of noise. Helicopters, airplanes, this. Did America ever win a war? Ever. Vietnam, they lost. Afghanistan, they lost. Against the Taliban, they lost. Against ISIS, they lost. They're running away now from Syria. In Iraq, they lost. They came back. Did they ever win a war? I'm asking you. Did America ever win a war? Show me one war they ever won. Nothing. They made Al-Qaeda to fight against Russia. Al-Qaeda turned against America, Bin Laden. The Twin Towers. 3,000 Americans died. They gave them money and trained them against Russia. What did they do? Came against America. The Americans don't understand the Muslim mentality. Now, Baruch Hashem, there's a normal president who understands who he's dealing with. But just until Hussein Obama, every American president was living in illusion. A clown. Doesn't understand who he's dealing with. He thinks that this Muslim would drop their Islam, Quran ideology for some money and training and weapon. Then, by the time, the faster the Americans and the Israeli will understand that the Muslim will not rest until they slaughter all the people in the world, the better it's going to be. In Europe, they begin to get the point. But a little bit too late, too little too late. Too little too late, Europe is finished. But here there's still a chance to save something. And I'll tell you something else. Jews that came to this country all become goyim. Every other nation that comes here become American. Spanish people that come here, 2-3 generations, become American. Yes, they still go with the Puerto Rican flag, but Puerto Rican kids in public school don't want to be like their parents. What's your name? Joe. No, your name is Jose. Wow, Joe. They change their names. They don't want anything. I'm not Puerto Rican. I'm American. The only one who stick to their culture and history is the Muslims. No matter what, I'm still a proud Muslim. Doesn't matter I'm born in America, I'm still Muslim. That comes before my nationality. That's the only people that are zealous and stick to their culture, even though it's built all on lies, and the Quran is not from God, but for the Quran they'll die. Take American Muslim who born here in America. Burn the Quran in front of him. See what's going to happen. What do you care? You're American. You're not from Iraq. You're not from Iran. You're not from Gaza. What do you care? You're American. You're supposed to be civilized. I'll burn the whole school. Say one word against Muhammad. 3 generations here in America. They still recruit them to all kinds of terrorist organizations. American birth. American people that were born here or in England or in France. They never change. They still radical Muslim after 3 generations after they are in the country. They do not become Americanized. They don't become French. They do not become German. They stay Muslim and they become more radical and more dangerous. Because you can't locate them. He looks German, he looks French, you don't really know. Looks American, walks in Wall Street, walks in hospital. You know one Israeli doctor, Arab, he wanted to poison an Israeli Haver Knesset that is, I'm in very good connection with. His name Oren Chazan. I tell him what to say in the Knesset that these lefties, obviously they're making a huge damage. How to fight them and to be strong against them? The Arab saw that he's a righty. He wanted to poison him in a hospital to give him a medicine to kill him. They just published it a few days ago. You teach them in Israeli university. Each student costs the government 100,000 shekel to graduate university. The government sponsor is $27,000 per student. Half of the students are Arabs. They don't go to the army. Age 18, they go to university. Age 22, 23, they can already be engineers. Age 24, 25, they are doctors. The Israelis have 3 more years after them because they have to go to the army for 3 years. So they milk us. They take our taxpayer money and they are traders from inside us who help the Hamas and the Hezbollah. But the one thing I don't understand is how can they be so dumb? If Hamas will take over Israel, God forbid, first one they will slaughter is them. Because they're not so religious, the Israeli Arabs. So what are they thinking? That under Hamas control, they're going to have better life, they're going to be able to go to university, they're going to be able to be doctors and lawyers and judges in Israeli court? Look what happened to them in Jordan, in Iraq, in Egypt. They were only raped and seduced and tortured and abused for generations in Saudi Arabia, in all these places. In Israel, they have paradise. Paradise. They build mansions on the Galilee, no pay, no taxes, no permit, they don't need any problem. They don't go to the army. They go to university and the government pay for them. Every child they have, they get monthly income from the government. They have 17 kids. They get tens of thousands of dollars. For each kid, they get a few hundred shekels a month. They live the life. You have to see what cars they're driving. Porsche, Ferrari, Mercedes. In America, people don't have cars like this. And what are they doing? Helping the Hamas to kill us, that if the Hamas will take over, they'll slaughter each one of them. The Hamas kill his own people. Hamas look at them. You are not proud Palestinian like us. You accepted Israeli citizenship. Meaning if the Hamas could, they kill them, of course. What's the question? And they know it. When you speak to them, my uncle that owned the pizza store, my cousins work there. Tell me, we speak to them. They tell us from all over the Middle East, living with you is the best option that we have. And 2 hours later, you hear on the news, he helped the Palestinian murderer to come and murder some Israelis. That's it. It is what it is. Last thing for today, and we finish. We have the pasuk, Machon leshivtecha pa'alta Hashem. Mikdash Hashem konenu yadecha. We know the Bet HaMikdash, the temporary Bet HaMikdash, the portable Bet HaMikdash, it's called Mishkan. Ve'akimoti et HaMishkan kemishpato asher oret ba'ar. From this pasuk we learn that there is oral Torah. Because Hashem said to Moshe Rabbeinu, build the Mishkan as I showed you in the mountain. What he showed him, it does not say in the written Torah. So you see that in Mount Sinai, Moshe not only got the written Torah, he got a lot of verbal instructions that are not written in the Torah. It's right here from this pasuk. Ve'akimoti et ha-mishkan ke-mishpato. I will build the Mishkan as the instruction. Asher oret ha-ba'ar. As the instructions that I gave you in the mountain. Where are the instructions? Only Moshe knew. And he taught it later on to the people. So from here you see a proof for Torah Shebe'al Peh, oral Torah. Miriam makes a party for all the women. Some people ask me, Rabbi, where does it say in the Torah that a mixed dancing party is not kosher? I think the rabbi exaggerates. Why does it have to be men here and women over there? Right in front of your eyes, Parashat B'Shalach. Moshe make a party to all the men. Miriam, ותצאנה כל הנשים אחריה בתופים ובמחולות. Miriam and the women far away. Moshe and the men far away. Why not Bukharian wedding? Syrian, Persian. Why not? Kulululu, like in the old days. What's the problem? Torah tells you, ma. Moshe and his sister. See, not strangers. And I promise you, the women back then were ultra, ultra modest. Each one of them was covered by a tent. Not like today. Little mini skirt. I'm religious, Rabbi. Yeah, sure. Walking on two pencils all day. Religious. Living in a dream. How many thousands of women, the way they dress, one generation ago, the prostitute on the street did not dare to dress like this. They called themselves religious. Skirt way above the knees, way and very tight, very high heels, no stocking, no nothing. Everything open, open sleeves all the way to the shoulders, open from here, a V or wide neck or in the back or clear, see-through, or elastic things that attach to the body. Not to talk about the long, not modest wig and tons of perfume and red lipstick and tons of things and tons of plastic surgeries. This is what Hashem had in mind for the Jewish woman. I leave the answer for you. I won't even answer that. Right away, the nation of Israel begin to complain. I just saved your life. Vailonu kol adat bnei Israel. Complains. What did they say? I wish we'll die in Egypt when we were sitting over there on a ball of meat and ate bread and were happy and full. Why did you take us out of Egypt to the desert to kill all of us here with hunger? In Auschwitz, they really serve steaks, lamb chops. How do you like it, Mr. Horvitz? Well done, medium rare. Do you like dessert? Turkish coffee, espresso maybe? How do you like a spaghetti? They were in gas chambers there in Egypt, in ghettos, in slavery, in camp, torture them, killing their babies. A month later, what they're saying, why you took us out of Egypt? We miss the meat, the watermelons, the melons. Do you ever believe such ungratefulness? How did Hashem not destroy them right there? I'm surprised. You need a big amount of tolerance to stand such ungratefulness. Did they really eat meat? They were dirty slaves, beaten up all day. The answer is, Rabotai, they were sitting next to the meatball when the Egyptians were eating. They were looking at them. They were only eating bread without the meat. They didn't say when we ate meat. They said when we ate bread and sat on the meatballs, the balls of meat. They have to be precise what the Torah says. Meaning, we would rather die in Egypt when the stomach is full than to die in the desert when the stomach is empty. What is it like, Rabotai? Like when you execute a person, you ask him, what is your final request? And what they always ask? Steak, a glass of wine, and Eichmann, Yimach Shimo, Adolf Eichmann, asked for a German newspaper also. Glass of wine, steak, you moron. In 1 hour, we're going to hang you. What is it going to help you now that you have steak in your stomach? And besides, what kind of a normal person can even chew a steak knowing in few minutes they're going to hang me? Huh? It's reality, Rabotai. It happened 30 years ago. That's what Eichmann asked for. From what he asked, you understand what kind of a monster he is. He's not even worried killing. He killed more than 1 million Jews by himself. At least 1 million he killed. Hitler was the general of the master plan. But the ones who made it is Rudolf Hess, Eichmann, and the Manuk, all these people. Each one is responsible. 10,000, 100,000, 150,000. He killed 1 million himself, at least 1 million. You killed 1 million people with your own hands. You say, I only follow order. We didn't think emotionally. We soldier. We must obey the rules. That's what he was answering. Now they're going to kill you. At least say, I'm so sorry. I would like to ask for forgiveness. I know nobody will forgive me, but at least I must ask for forgiveness for what I did. I wish I can turn the wheel back. I would not do it. Please forgive me. Not a word. No regret, no shame, no nothing. You had to see how he was drinking the wine, reading German newspaper like he's on a beach in Aruba, next to Gorbachev. This is how he was drinking, like this. Yeah, they documented him. Unbelievable. No. Can you believe such a thing? Why do you care about German food? German newspaper, what do you care about it? What is it going to give you now? What are you going to read? The temperature in Berlin? Who resigned in Berlin? What accident they had on a train? What do you care? You're going to die in an hour. That's the difference between a Jew and a monster of these Nazis. What's the difference? A Jew 1 month before Rosh Hashanah, you tell them, Rosh Chodesh Elul, tomorrow morning, Slichot. Half of the Jews are fainting. Wow, Rosh Hashanah in 1 month. I did not even start my tshuva yet. I would like to finish, Bezrat Hashem, like remind you that in the next 2 Tuesdays I won't be here, but I'll be back in the third one, which will be February 5th. Everyone who can sponsor more CDs, more books, more USBs, now I need it more than ever. That said, the storage is empty. My trunk, as you can see, for the first time in 10 years, is totally empty. Don't have any CDs left. People do not donate. I don't know. Maybe now they waited the end of last year. It was good for their taxes. New Year came. Almost everybody stopped. Plus, I had one guy that was a very serious supporter. He said that now until Pesach, he cannot help. That's a very big problem because I don't have CDs to give people. Already few lectures I went and I did not give one CD. People ask, you have CDs? You have CDs? I could have given thousands of CDs. I didn't have one. So now, if you don't help now, when are you going to help? After Mashiach comes, it's too late. You're going to be left with all the money in a bank. It's not going to help you anymore. Now you need it. For you, not for me. For you to save other Jews, for your own good. For your own future, for your own Olam Haba. We have Venmo. Venmo app. It's very good. You send money with no fees. You open it up in 2 minutes. You link it to your bank account. You send, my username is Rabbi Mizrachi, no space. Rabbi Mizrachi, one word. In 2 seconds, we get the money, no fees. Plus, you have credit cards, PayPal, subscribe. That's the best option, because if people subscribe to monthly donation, then I know that I have a monthly budget. I can calculate, soon I'm having money next month. You don't know what's going to happen. Sometimes you want to order, you don't have money. All of a sudden, money come. Now it's too late to order. You have to wait. Bezrat Hashem, even the books, we made it in China to save money, 70% of the cost. But it takes them 2 months to make it and another month to ship it. They take your heart out, these Chinese people. The cheap, it's actually expensive. I had a financially healthy organization that has a lot of donations, like all these American organizations who raise tens of millions of dollars every year. I wouldn't need to run to China and make it over there. We'd do it right away, pay here quickly, and then in 2 weeks you would have it all over. We have to suffer 3 months until they ship the things, and then when it gets here, we have to pay 10% for the tax that Trump did, and then duties, and then shipping, and then to ship it to Monsi. Believe me, it's a nightmare. But one thing for sure, once the books will be out, we will have thousands of new Baalei Tshuva right away. Everyone will read this book, will not remain the same. I promise you this. So for that, we need more donation. Please do it. Right now is the right time to do it. Baruch Adonai Lo'olam. Amen ve'amen. Rabbi Chanan.